prochain invité est un rocker qui a marqué les années 70 et qui est loin d'avoir dit son dernier mot. Voici Peter Frampton. Peter Frampton, bienvenue à Tout le monde en parle. Vous êtes de passage chez nous pour nous annoncer votre spectacle le 30 juin prochain à Montréal au Festival de jazz. C'est votre premier concert à Montréal depuis 35 ans et vous recréez le même spectacle de 1976 qui est devenu l'album Frampton Comes Alive, moins les cheveux. Pourquoi ce voyage dans le temps?
We came here in 77 and... I just apologize for not being here sooner. It's taken my, I've taken my time, haven't I? But we're coming back to do this year being the 35th anniversary of it. we're going to come back and do Frampton Comes Alive from beginning to end, just like the record. It's a completely three-hour show, and we're going to do some other from my... other albums as well.
On va se faire plaisir et écouter quelques extraits de l'album Frampton Comes Alive.
I love the guy. I still love the guy. I didn't know where he was, so
Monsieur
now
le maire,
I know.
Si vous voulez voler Peter Frampton au Festival de Jazz, c'est le temps de lui faire une offre. Là, cette
ah! Well, anyway, we're going to have a discussion after the show. Yeah. On va se parler après, là.
Peter Frampton, vous êtes né en 1950 en Angleterre. Vous avez découvert la musique à l'âge de 7 ans. Dès l'âge de 10 ans, vous faisiez partie d'un band et vous avez fréquenté la même école qu'un certain David Bowie, qui lui aussi avait son propre band. Est-ce que vous étiez en compétition?
Never in competition. He was only a couple of years older than me, but he was always just that little bit further ahead. So he was in a band before I was in a band, you know. So I always looked up, still look up to David. He's always been a great inspiration.
À l'âge de 18 ans, vous avez formé un groupe appelé Humble Pie avec lequel vous avez fait quelques albums et vous avez quitté le band en 1971 pour entamer votre carrière solo. Frampton Comes Alive est devenu un des albums live les plus vendus de tous les temps. 6 millions de copies aux États-Unis, 16 millions à travers le monde. Est-ce que vous avez vu venir ce succès-là et comment vous l'expliquez?
Nothing can really prepare you for that. It's something that... very few people have been quite to that point and experienced that. It was the biggest selling record in history when it first came out, you know. So that's something you never expect, and it's something that I'll obviously always be remembered for more than anything else. I know that.
La chanson Do You Feel Like I Do est devenue un succès radio. Alors qu'elle durait 14 minutes et 15 secondes, c'est totalement impossible ça aujourd'hui en radio.
Absolutely. A lot of DJs, I think, invited their girlfriends in when they played that song. And I'm told that there's a lot of children born after that. So.
Peter, on va vous regarder à cette époque-là, Manon.
Come on, baby. I can't wait. Ooh. Ooh, baby, I love you. Sing along. que vous aimez ça, vous revoir à 26 ans?
It's on my Facebook page. They post it all the time, all the fans. So, yeah, I'm used to it. That's me. I'm a little sad about the hair, it's just one of those things that I'm very proud of that period, obviously, of my career.
Mais est-ce que le sex symbol a fait ombrage aux musiciens que vous étiez parce que vous êtes un excellent guitariste?
I was first in a band successful in Europe, the Herd, and I became the pop icon from that band. And then, so I left that band to form Humble Pie. And I think that building and doing a lot of very high profile sessions mm-hmm. for a lot of different people, George Harrison and Harry Nilsson, people like that, David Bowie, and my credibility, when Frampton Comes Alive came out and there were all these front covers of the magazines, and to be a pop icon is a very short career, but to be a musician is a lifetime, you know. So I think that as well as Frampton Comes Alive being obviously a huge seller and brought me to the forefront of around the world, the image created after it sort of douse the flames of the musician. You're absolutely right.
Vous avez consommé de l'alcool et de la drogue et tout à l'heure, je vous ai vu tasser le verre de vin. Vous êtes sobre depuis 8 ans.
Demandé, là.
Est-ce que le parcours a été difficile?
The last, it's 8.5 years now, has been the best time of my life.
Bravo, and, monsieur. Bravo.
Yeah, it's... Appreciate that. Thank you. I can't sit here and say I don't think, oh, everything's fine now. But I do wish that maybe I'd have done that earlier. But you can't change things, you know. No. Things are the way they're supposed to be in one's life. So, but if anything, I realized what that period did for me post Frampton Comes Alive, when I was using stuff and drinking, was that it dulled the passion and dulled the creativity. And over the last nearly 9 years, I've had two very critically acclaimed albums and oui. Got a Grammy. So I don't think it's coincidental that the two things happened at the same time.
Peter, vous avez largement contribué à nous faire découvrir les effets de la talk box. C'est comme si vous parliez dans votre guitare, on va vous regarder jouer, Manon. Mais le talk box, est-ce que c'était votre invention?
No. The talk box was actually invented in around 1940, something like that. Okay. The person that I heard it from or saw play it was when I was doing the sessions for All Things Must Pass with George Harrison. And Pete Drake, the pedal steel player, mm-hmm. came over from Nashville and in the U.S. and played on all the country tracks. And he was set up right next to me. I was playing acoustic. He was playing the pedal steel. And then there was a break one day, and he got out this little box with a pipe and plugged things in here and there, and then put the pipe in his mouth and started playing the pedal steel, and it started mm-hmm. singing to me and talking to me. And I went, you know, that was, can I get one of those? And he said, no.
No.
but the one he had was actually the one that Joe Walsh used for Rocky Mountain Way.
Est-ce que vous l'avez encore, celle-là?
That one is actually it travels around the Hard Rock cafes.
Oh, oui.
So
okay.
The suit, the guitar, the talk box, they all travel around together with the wig, you know.
Oh. Au cours des années 80, vous avez pris un autre chemin. Vous avez retrouvé votre ami d'enfance, David Bowie, avec qui vous avez joué sur son album Never Let Me Down. Vous l'avez même accompagné dans sa tournée mondiale. Est-ce que c'est dur de se retrouver dans l'ombre d'une star quand on a déjà été soi-même la star?
No, you see, the thing is, I've always been most comfortable as the gunslinger, as the guy behind the singer. It's way too much pressure to do the singing. I enjoy singing, don't get me wrong. But my default position is playing guitar behind a great singer. I love that the most, whether it's been Steve Marriott, David Bowie, Paul Rodgers. I've had the pleasure of playing behind all these great people. And that would be my favorite position if I had to choose one.
L'an dernier, vous avez fait paraître un nouvel album, Thank You, Mr. Churchill. Votre fils Julian collabore sur cet album. On va en écouter quelques extraits.
Jusqu'au Madrid, là, tout ça.
Peter, vous aurez 61 ans demain. Et les gens du Festival de jazz de Montréal et les guitares Godin ont décidé de vous offrir une guitare Godin. Une guitare à trois micros fabriquée à Québec.
Oh, my goodness! Wow! Look at that! Good Lord! Thank you! You're kidding me!
No!
Oh, that's fantastic. Look at how beautiful that is. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bienvenue.
That's good.
C'est pas Guy, c'est le Festival de jazz.
C'est le Festival de jazz et c'est les guitares Godin qui vous jouent.
Là, t'as pas de fun, puis Jeremy Writer,